Mischa, Marcks here, the dude who thinks that bass is all you need, and I want to welcome you to Mission Bass Live, the show where we put bass into the spotlight. If you want access to the chat, unfortunately, you're going to have to subscribe to my channel, but that's a small price to pay to get all your questions answered. And yeah, today, you know the show, the returning viewers know the show, where I invite guests from around the world, solo bassists, to present their music and their project. But I thought, well, there's one struggle that I've heard basically every single solo bassist had at some point in their career. And that is injuries from practicing too much or in the wrong way or just simply overdoing it because you're so motivated and determined to finish this piece, finish this record, prepare for the show. So today we're gonna dive deep into injury prevention, and my very special guest from the UK is the author of this book, Effortless Guitar. Don't get scared, guitar is close enough to bass, and I was assured that he plays some bass too, so there's actually a chapter about bass in there. So there you go. We're covered. And even the whole rest of the book that is primarily written for guitarists is 100% applicable to us. There is, of course, some picking tips in there, but for once I believe that bass can be played with a pick. It's not a sin. And on the other hand, maybe you just want to level up your double thumping game. I was thinking of using some of those exercises to do exactly that. So one last ask from me to you. Let us know where you're watching from and let us know if you can hear us okay. I've got a little remote here nowadays, so I don't have to get up to adjust levels. I can do it on the fly. Let us know if you can hear Adrian, if you can hear me, if you can hear the bass. Going to be some playing from yours truly. And I will say, let's give a big applause and welcome to our guest today, Adrian Farrell.
Hi, Mischa.
Hey, Adrian. How's it going?
Good. Thanks for inviting me. So I'm just getting used to which side my lens is on, so I can look over here.
Yeah. That looks about all right.
Yeah. So, yeah, it's a bit odd because I have to actually look at myself rather than you. This is how we love to all look at ourselves. Well, thank you very much for inviting me. Yes, the book is called Effortless Guitar because it needs a title, but it's just as relevant to bass players. In fact, it's just as relevant to the first sort of half of the book is relevant to all human beings and probably all instrumentalists. But yeah, I used to play bass as well as guitar. I used to play bass in bands more than guitar because there was more need for it. You know, better to play bass in a band than guitar in your bedroom. But over the years, I've probably gone back to more guitar and more guitar. And back in the day, you know, when I first started out, I mean, I was a young man, so I was fairly, you know, fit and healthy. So I got away with murder probably. But I have to say, I used to find after rehearsals and gigs, you know, I would ache and it caused no long term damage. But compared to the guitar, the bass is... It takes a lot out of you. It really does. And if anything, you know, this book is probably more beneficial to bass players than guitar players in some respects. But I was commissioned to write the book by Luke at Guitar Vivo. And obviously he wanted a guitar book.
You actually wrote a book for bassists, but under the cover of it being a guitar book.
No, not at all. Not at all. He wanted a book for guitar players. And I said, well, this is just as relevant for bass players as well.
Yeah.
He at the moment is completely focused on his publishing and he's got some great people involved. You know, I don't know how well you guys are familiar with guitar players, but he's done workshops like with Scott Henderson and who's the sweep legend from Australia? The name escapes me. it will come back into my brains in a minute. But, you know, people we've been reading around about in magazines for like 30-odd years. So he's well-connected, but it's all guitar. And that's his market niche, I guess. But I said, look, come on. You ought to at least put a chapter in for bass. And it did... It's better than not having it there, but I think from a marketing point of view, it does say guitar on the front.
Yeah.
So it is what it is.
Well, and it is what this show is about, to hopefully level that balance that out a little bit.
Oh, yeah, I've tried.
Yeah, exactly. Beautiful show. Where did you get it from?
Popped up free in the post.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, actually, let me right away put something in the chat, and that is the link to your book. So, people, if you want to check out Adrian's book, link's in the chat, and you can grab it right there, copy from Amazon. I read it in the last 2 weeks since I got it, and I have
to
say...
You have a lot of questions.
I've been through a lot of injury history myself with my arms and exactly in context with playing bass. And I thought I basically knew everything there is to know, but while not everything in the book was new to me, definitely the perspective was new in most cases. And I find just as having different perspectives on learning a new bass technique, different approaches on how to practice something, changing the instrument every once in a while so you have to adjust again and have a little bit a newer challenge, a new perspective to look at it, and finding out, oh wait, with this instrument I'm gonna have to change my position a little bit. It's the same with any type of information. Whenever someone else gives you the same information, and I'm not even saying it's the same information that I already knew, but of course in parts I was aware of the concepts of Alexander technique. I didn't really know myself what it was, but I guess anything that has to do with injury prevention, in particular for musicians, has some crossover points. So yeah,
I'm gonna pick up on something you said that I thought was interesting about swapping between instruments, because something I read a while back, it was a sports science study on tennis and baseball swings. And they found the less variability someone had, the less skillful they were.
Yeah.
So the idea of being right all the time, get your technique right, leads to problems in itself. And the fact that you've said what you've said about swapping instruments creates variability, therefore adaptability. And that creates freedom. And that's something I've written a lot about, and it's sort of the cornerstone, and it's a good way to start this conversation, actually, that you know, I always say to my students, I'm not interested in you doing things correctly, but freely. We need to be adaptable. And there is a terrible handicapped psychology with trying to be right.
Yeah. I mean, I know that from teaching my students a lot, especially the kids, they're very motivated, some of them. And they give it all, but often they do it correctly one time. And then they're like, okay, I got it. And they basically expect from that time in, from that point in time, to always be able to perform at that level, no matter the context. Because they did it once, right? What's there to go wrong ever from here?
The interesting thing is that was the only time they were going to get it right that way. And it will never be right that way again. You can never, it's an old cliche, you can never step in the same river twice. So every time you play something is the first and last time you'll ever, ever play it like that.
Yeah.
And I say that about any movement patterns. You know, we're known within the Alexander technique to use very basic, simple movement patterns, just functional movement, to test people's reflexes and thinking and coordination. And we just use sitting and standing just because it's everyone can do it. It's simple. It saves me having to run around a room chasing someone. You know, it's right there. It makes my life easier. Yeah. You know, it makes all Alexander teachers' jobs easier. But every time we do it, every time I get and sit and stand or go into a full squat or whatever, however good it felt, you'll never repeat it. So you need to be adaptable.
Yeah.
So, you know, being right that one time is great. But you need a kind of, you know, maybe there's an idealized right in the middle, but you need like a, around it, you need lots of, if you were to put data points around this ideal point, you want to have lots of them around it. Obviously not too far out because then you're not very skilled, but you know, the further those data points are out, you obviously just can't play. But you want to get a cluster around it. And that's what you want to practice for, that cluster, not the point. Because you can never achieve the point again. You know, you're in a different mood. You're in a different position. The tempo is slightly different. You've got new strings on. You've got old strings on. You know, you're tired. You're not tired.
Yeah, so absolutely.
You've got to be adaptable.
Yeah. I mean, there's a whole discussion going on about how much of your character is inherited and genetically passed on and how much of it is taught. And although this speaks against the current science, I'm still of the belief that 99% of what you are, who you are, and how you act is taught to you by your own experiences. And we yet have to understand how really basically going to the chaos theory, any little tiny detail of your life every second can change your life completely. And it really depends what type of day it is, how much the sun is shining and how much rain there is, how much noise is there in the background, what have you experienced the last few weeks, what's still on your mind, what have you dreamt, what are you scared about, what's going to happen today, are you worried about anything? And all of these come together in such a complex way that you never, as you said, can have the same situation again. So exactly. How would you be able to perform at the exact same, I mean, you might be able to perform at the same level, but it's still going to be different.
Yeah, but you want it to be different. Every performance was exactly the same, just put the record on.
Yeah, I mean,
yeah,
I'm not sure if everyone, I agree with you. I'm not sure if everyone else does. I'm sure there's
I like rock and roll at the end of the day. That's my genre. You know, I like classic rock. I mean, I like all sorts of music, but I like the excitement and the mess of being on the edge and it never being quite the same. You know, I love Jeff Beck and, you know, you're never going to get the same thing twice out of him, or Jimmy Page, never get the same thing, or Eddie Van Halen. You're never going to get the same thing twice out of them. And I prefer that than people who aim to try and dial it down so it's exactly reproducible, like off the record. So I'm like, well, if I want to listen to the record, I can listen to the record. And I like improvisation. I want to hear people muck about a bit with, you know, go around the theme a bit and not necessarily play the solo exactly the same way twice, you know. That's what interests me. Even though, I mean, I like jazz a lot as well. And obviously, improvisation is totally the key in jazz. And for the same reasons, I can't listen to a jazz record too many times because it stops being improvised. Because I know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So really, I've got these great jazz albums that I used to love and I can't listen to them anymore. So I'm like, yeah, well, I know what's coming next. What's the point?
that's a very good point. I've never thought about it that way. Maybe I haven't listened to jazz albums that repetitively. I studied jazz and I really enjoy playing it, enjoy listening to it. Now I'm also working in a club where there's a lot of jazz concerts. So just yesterday there were three bands that we mixed, and coming back to the whole people want to be repetitive or consistent, as consistent with a performance as possible, or maybe not. There was a drummer, and she was, I mean, from a metalhead perspective, it was a blast beat she was playing in between. It was just like tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk-tuk. But just because she was a jazzer, you could absolutely hear that it was inconsistent, but it was planned to be inconsistent. If it wouldn't have been inconsistent, it would not have fit to the music. And that's the interesting bit. Whereas I think in a tech metal band, to some degree, the highest goal that you can have is to get that top performance that has very specific parameters that you can measure the level of the performance. And you always
reach different style. There are different styles. I mean, it's no right or wrong about it. I have preferences. It's one of the reasons I often like the guitars in metal music, it's the drums I struggle with because of that. They don't breathe for me.
I particularly like the drums and metal. I don't care.
Oh yeah, I struggle with that. Yeah, I mean, I grew up with like Keith Moon and John Bonham. You know, that's the way things breathe. That's what I like to hear. I never really understood that. Like, I was going to use the word clinical. It sounds a bit judgmental, but I never really understood the metal style of drumming from a feel perspective. You know, what I like to feel, just an emotional thing. But you know, it's good. We all like different things.
Exactly. So, shall we get
to it?
Into the depth of the Alexander technique. We had a chat before this to just go through a couple of topics that we might want to discuss. I now read your book head to toe. And I have another 13 points on my list that I would like to go through. we're probably not going to manage all of them, and some of these might be actually the same ones that we agreed upon before. But just to get an idea what Alexander technique is compared to other movement practices like Feldenkrais and maybe even yoga or Tai Chi, because sure. A lot of these I don't even know what to call the box to put them all into, if you can even do that, but
it's generally the phrase is body work.
Yes, thank you.
Which we don't think we fall into.
Perfect. Exactly. That's what I wanted to hear. So, but there's nowadays, I find more and more people talking about this in context with avoiding injuries as a musician or even as doing sports. If you include the whole movement, slow and conscious movement, I guess that's the closest thing that really matches to Alexander technique. But please, in your words, what's the difference and why would you not want to be included?
Firstly, we don't treat a person as a body. I mean, how would you feel if every time I spoke to you, I just treated you as a sack of meat? You don't think of yourself as a sack of meat. And who am I really talking to when I talk to Mischa? You know, there's something far more fascinating than in another person than, you know, the physicality. And that's your thinking, who you are inside there. Now, I think there are some wonderful parallels, actually, with some of these other modalities. And I think it's an important point to make, I should make, that no modality, whether it's the Alexander technique or yoga or anything really, none of them invent human experience. They're all human experiences. And I think if they're done well, I mean, yoga often has a problem just because the psychology of group classes and people in their best lycra in Western gyms. And it leads to unfortunate psychological behavior. And sometimes you've got good teachers who are really on top of that. But it's difficult when you've got a large group of people in the class. That's more to do with that situation. But sometimes, you know, that situation means yoga gets not at its best. There's nothing wrong with yoga itself, but sometimes the way it's presented means something gets lost because of things like you've read in the book, like end gaining behavior, the psychology of being right, trying to, you know, get that little bit further and try a bit harder. And all these things then start to get in the way. But yoga, when it's done well, is an exploration. Tai Chi, for example, I think dovetails beautifully with the Alexander technique. They talk about qi. I do not believe there's mystical energy called qi at all. And I've done a lot of Tai Chi in my past, all the way up to basically my kids were born and then life, you know. What we would call qi in the Alexander technique is thinking and activity. But it's the same flow and presence. But we have different cultural and academic understandings of how we achieve that flow and presence. And we've got some specific observations about what does an interference pattern look like. Because what you're really trying to do is prevent an interference pattern. We're not really trying to get things correct. You know, much like Tai Chi and Taoism, I often call Alexander technique Western Taoism for a laugh. But, you know, if you prevent the wrong, the right will do itself.
Can you?
So we're very much about prevention.
Example for that? Can you give a practical?
A simple one would be just when we get people to sit and stand, for example, is how much people are using their head and their neck to use their legs, and it completely discoordinates the whole organism. So if you cannot use your head and neck to stand up, which you might think is a really weird thing to use, the head, neck and shoulders, stand up.
Yeah.
I can promise you everyone does it.
Oh.
And then it just coordinates the whole thing. So if you can prevent that, and we've got a phrase for it, and it's not my favorite phrase in the world, but we call it the primary control. We're very obsessed about the head-neck relationship. I don't think it's the be all and end all. I think it's a very useful barometer and a window in. So I use it like all my colleagues do, but I don't necessarily worship at its altar. It's just a practical tool. because, you know, when we react as a whole and react to little finger, but from a pedagogical point of view, there's not a lot I can do with someone's reaction of a little finger. It's a very difficult way to teach someone about observing themselves in activity. Whereas the head and neck relationship is a very useful one. So, you know, what would the wrong thing be? You know, holding your breath, you know, when the difficult part comes, do you need to hold? If you can prevent that reaction, then you're not holding your breath. And everything that leads to holding your breath thing isn't actually just holding the breath either. It's a whole nervous system holding. It's a whole attitude of mind.
Yeah.
And one of the, we don't classify ourselves as body workers because central to the Alexander technique is the idea of psychophysicality. So that is René Descartes was wrong, that the mind and body aren't connected because to be connected, they need to be separate. You can only connect separate things.
Yeah.
And Descartes in the West was encouraged by the Catholic Church to do that and write that because they got heavy on him because they wanted the soul to be separate. So then he was encouraged for thinking and mind to be separate too.
Yeah.
Now in the East, you know, that's probably a tradition that they're like, oh, well, that's just weird. But they're coming round in the West now with what do they call it? Cognitive, I've forgotten the phrase they use for it, but there is a study in psychology now that incorporates the idea of psychophysicality, that a person, you cannot separate from a functional point of view your thinking and your physicality. From a functional point of view, they're a singular entity. After all, what's the point of having a physical functioning thing if there's no mental intention for it to be involved in anything? So the body for us is the outer manifestation of our thinking. But it's our thinking that we're interested in. But that's not to throw away. That's not to throw away the physicality. It's a split. Well, I say split. Yeah. No split. It's a continuum. Psychophysicality. So we do have a physicality, and we want the physicality to be as efficient as possible. Because the more efficient it is, the less strain it is on you. The less strain it is on you, the less likely you are to overreact to a stimulus. So it's easier to keep a flow. We have a phrase, mechanical advantage, and you can over egg mechanical advantage. It's an advantage, not a guarantee. The guarantees come from your thinking. And of course, thinking is ephemeral and there's no guarantee there either. I mean, if you're ill or you're tired, your use, as we call it, or your functioning, your behavior starts to deteriorate. And so be it. You know, there's not a lot you can do about it.
Interrupt you just to clear something up. Stimulus. Can you give us a few examples? Because I think most people have a vague idea of what a stimulus can be, but in your book, I noticed that in Alexander technique, it goes way beyond what usually is interpreted as a stimulus.
Oh, okay. I would think
of a source of pain as the first association, just to give you something to start from. Like a pinch is a stimulus, but...
It is a stimulus, and we overreact to it. And we forget that the rest of ourselves is still part of the equation, and we ignore the rest of ourselves while we're feeling that pinch, as if that pinch operates, that area operates individually on its own without the support of the whole. We function as a whole. So any local pain areas can only be helped by the whole. And it's a holistic, we are very much holistic in the way we look at things. Interesting what Alexander said about his own work. I don't know how well our audience has heard of the Alexander technique. I know we're very much known for posture, and we have to live with it. We've only got ourselves to blame, I think. We should have put a better message out there. I much prefer the word poise because it far better encompasses psychophysicality, because poise is a quality of mind and thinking, nervous system, as much as it is a position, an alignment. Yeah. I have no interest in positions and alignment whatsoever. But I'll come back to that. But what Alexander said about his work was it was dealing with the stimulus of living. And I really like that phrase because living is very open and it implies two things, external and internal stimulus. We can be very much be a stimulus to ourselves through our attitudes and our beliefs. And obviously external, because, you know, when someone shouts at you, you react, you get annoyed. You might react to that. So we're very much about trying to learn to respond to things as well as we can, rather than react. I'm no Buddha yet. My kids can still get under my skin. You know, on a bad day. But I'm learning, you know, I've learned over the years that, as from a parenting point of view, that ability to stay a little more neutral means we don't spiral out of control together. So if my kids are getting in my case and I get react back, then of course they react back to that, and blah, 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 and then it all spirals out of control. Just an everyday example. What can happen, say, with playing your bass is you notice the discomfort and you go into it and you get drawn into the discomfort. So that drags you away from the holistic, how you're doing the general thing. It drags you away from the support. And the irony is, the more you concentrate on an individual area, trying to micromanage it, the more you interfere with it.
Yeah.
So that pain stimulus then becomes a stimulus to interfere further.
So how do we solve it? Because just to, again, give you a place to start on, I'm not clinically OCD, but I'm definitely a control freak. I love micromanaging my whole life, from my technique to how I structure my day and plan things out. Not that I always follow through with them. That's a completely different story. But the idea of being in control and managing every little aspect is somewhat dear to me.
I have an answer for that.
But I have already also experienced the freedom that I have when, especially when I play music, but also in conversation, for example, on this show, just to give you one example, that just being in the moment and going for it, going with it, being present is such a beautiful experience and generally gets me where I want to get with micromanaging, or gets me further to where I want to get using micromanaging. But it's really hard to consciously do that switch for me to say, okay.
Yeah, I think it is for all of us. I think we have a culture that's glorified concentration in a way from our early schooling. And we make a habit out of that. Of course, some of these traits are really useful tools. They're really useful things to be able to do, to micromanage in that way and look at fine detail and stuff. The problem is we make a habit out of it to the point that we're permanently narrowed into that kind of thinking, and we forget how to zoom back out again. So what we like to do in the Adrian technique is, it's not to say it's wrong to do that. We're saying, if you had the choice, can you stop doing it? And if you can't, that's the problem. So when you said you're a control freak, it made me smile, because I say almost on a daily basis, certainly every time I have a new client, I say, look, we're all control freaks. You want to be in control.
Who doesn't?
And I want
right?
you. Yeah. But here's the irony, because I'm always asking people to surrender control, because it's getting in the way.
Yeah.
Because if you can't surrender control, you never had it.
Yeah, that's deep.
I thought you might like that. So that's real control. That's Alexander thinking, you know, reverse engineering this stuff. Like I say, it is very Taoist in principle. I mean, these are they're not necessarily all of them purely original ideas. They're observations about human behavior. And of course, different traditions and people have clocked this for centuries and millennia. And Alexander certainly made his observations. And I hope they do dovetail with other traditions, because if we're observing human behavior, which is what he was doing initially just in himself, and then he realized, hey, it's not just me, everyone's doing this stuff. we would expect to see some similarities and observations across modalities and cultures, because I don't think we're that fundamentally different as humans. I mean, we have we are all unique, but at the same time, there's some traits that as humanity, we're all very susceptible to. And if you can't not do something, that's the issue.
The go-no-go pathway.
So I'll repeat that. If you can't surrender control, you never had it.
Yeah. I think I'm going to have to print that out and put it on my wall. But yeah, that is actually, that's a very, very good way to put it, because that's exactly the experience of being in the now when I play music, for example, and I completely get lost in it and lose track of time and space.
But you are in control during those moments.
Exactly.
But it's a different sort of control, isn't it?
Yeah. And I'm deciding to let go of that control. Manage. Oh, actually.
And that is the control. That is the control, ironically.
Yeah. Oh, man, that's great. Okay, let me. Oh, no, Antonio is late. Hey, Antonio. Sorry you're late. All that late, just half an hour. And I have to rewatch the beginning. But yeah, everyone that's watching, if you've ever experienced any type of pain from the normal, usual stuff that we all have, from desk work, neck pain, shoulder pain, or wrist pain from typing, from playing your instrument, please ask your specific questions in the chat. Today's the day where you can get free advice from this amazing dude here. And while you're still formulating your questions, I'm going to take advantage and get mine answered. One of the things that for me was really hard to grasp, because I always had a not completely different idea, but somewhat different idea, is the head forward and up thing that you keep mentioning throughout the book. And I wasn't quite sure. Obviously, this is end gaining. I want the concrete answer how to do it correctly. But the truth is, I've had an experience, because you in particular mentioned sleeping, this exercise where you lie on your back and you put something to lift up your head a little bit, like a book or a yoga block, you said. And then we do this. Go through this whole routine. But what surprised me was lifting up the head, because I always had the feeling that if I have a stiff neck, if I slept bad, it was because I had too much, maybe fell asleep in a position with too many pillows behind my neck, where my chin was almost touching my chest. And then usually it kind of resetted when I slept 1 to 3 nights completely without a pillow, where my head was really going further back. And you said that that was not the natural position. And can you go a little bit deeper into that whole thing?
Sure. Okay. So the head neck relationship is kind of the starting point for the Alexander technique, the way that the head balances on top of the spine. First, I should say there is no correct position. There's no such thing as a correct position. You're free to move around and do all sorts of things. But there is a natural balance point around which you want some level of skill to return to. So head forward and up is interesting. You said, how do you do it? Well, you kind of don't. You let it by surrendering. Because gravity does it for you. We use gravity like a fish uses water. And, more need to do good posture than a fish needs to do good buoyancy. It's the byproduct of our environment. 50% of your posture is provided by your environment, the planet, and the other 50% is provided by you not getting in the way of that. Take that with a pinch of salt. Obviously, you have to learn from a toddler upwards to to deal with this balancing on this planet's surface. And so, you know, we're not born with an innate ability to balance. We have to train up the cerebellum at the back of the brain to take in information to use this environment to our advantage. And that's what we do. We use our environment to an advantage. And there's no such thing. I know I'm going to riff a bit. I'll try. Do prod me if I go off a bit off tangent. There's no such thing as functioning without an environment. You can't function without an environment. Functioning is the relationship between you and your environment. In other words, if you take a fish out of water, it's non-functioning. And if you take a human being off the planet's surface, we become non-functioning. Obviously, we can still live and, you know, breathe and stuff in free fall for a while, but we can't do much useful. We need the traction of the ground. For example, if you're astronauts on the International Space Station, they get quite sick from being in permanent freefall. They're not in zero gravity, by the way. Gravity on the International Space Station is only 10% less than it is here on Earth. But it must be gravity, otherwise they wouldn't be in orbit. So anything in orbit is obviously in gravity, otherwise it would just zoom off a straight line somewhere. But they're effectively in freefall all the time, and it's really bad for their health. One of the things they weirdly end up with is back pain. There you go. You think gravity is causing you back pain? Lack of gravity will cause you back pain. Well, I say lack of gravity. I mean, it's in gravity, but in free fall, same relative equivalent. This is our water, the ground. This is our friend. This is our ally completely. And I'll come back to that because that's a whole other subject on gravity itself and how it really works, because unfortunately, Isaac Newton was wrong.
Just to clear one question that might pop up, it definitely does in my head, even if it's a bit tongue in the cheek. Are you suggesting we'd have less back pain if we'd all wear weighted vests and body weights
to enhance the gravity? No, I'm suggesting no, because we have evolved to take advantage of 9.8 meters per second squared. We haven't evolved, in your suggestion, maybe, to do 1.5, you know, say 15 meters per second squared of acceleration. Yeah. 1G is 9.8 meters per second squared. Gravity is measured in acceleration. If we were on a, you know, in greater acceleration, we would probably evolve to be squatter and shorter.
Yeah.
So we're perfectly evolved for this acceleration. So nothing needs to change. It's all there. It's all perfect. It's fine.
Then, but to go, does body weight have an impact on?
Do you mean body mass?
On gravity or how you experience gravity?
Yeah. So force equals mass times acceleration, which is the same as weight. Weight is mass times acceleration.
Yeah.
So force and weight are effectively the same thing, because mass and weight are not the same thing.
Yeah.
I had a word with one of my kids' teachers at primary school. I said, why are you in this homework? Are you saying weight? You're writing as if mass and weight's the same thing, and it's not. And he says, well, you know, it's primary school. That's where we start. I go, yeah, well, it's not helpful, is it? Because I didn't say this to them, but I'm just thinking, why are we still teaching Newtonianism? I mean, it's a quite, he was an absolute genius. And his equations are really, really useful at a local level. When I say local, I mean even to, you know, the solar system. But you get between galaxies and stuff, and weird stuff starts happening. And we notice through gravitational lensing, for example, that his theory is obviously completely broken down. So people think gravity is a force and it drags them down, and it isn't, and it doesn't. And your weight is the relationship between your mass, how much stuff there is of you, and the speed of the acceleration. And the speed of the acceleration is related, obviously, to the mass of, I mean, our own mass does come into it, but it's negligible compared to the mass of the entire planet. So that mass of that planet is creating acceleration. So your weight is basically the relationship between the planet and your mass. Of course, what that basically means is your weight is a relationship between your mass and the Earth's mass. But
yeah.
It's just that ours is so negligible, I can't even say the word, negligible compared to, you know, an entire planet. But we'll come back to that because it's important. But I want to backtrack to your original question. Because
yes,
you
please.
Said, how do you do the head forward and up? The classic phrase is, and I never liked this phrase, by the way, and I didn't use it myself for donkey's years, and I didn't like it throughout my 3-year training course. And I kind of found it useful by the end of my training course for no other reason. I had a Pavlovian response to the phrase because I'd been given the experience of head forward and up so many times by my teachers, I could associate the phrase. But I didn't like the phrase. I was just one of those people that never slouched anyway. I come from two generations of military family. I lived, grew up on military bases. Funny enough, in Germany, Michelle, I hadn't actually realized till you sent me your address that you're in Köln. I used to live near Mönchengladbach as a kid, near the southern Dutch border. So I was always very kind of pushed up, military bearing. So I relatively need to learn to slightly slouch a bit compared to where I was. So telling me to put my head forward, no, I was like, well, I'm bloody well already up here. So it was just one of those unfortunate stimuli as a phrase. That phrase was a stimulus to me that was unhelpful to me. So it's not a Catholic catechism to go around saying head forward and up. It needs context. I ended up falling in love with the phrase because it turned out to be a great observation, but I need the context. And understanding gravity was the context. And it's a shame Alexander didn't understand that. He made a good observation. But Einstein was a contemporary of his. If he'd picked up on that work, he'd go, look, this genius Einstein's validated my work. But, you know. He didn't see that, unfortunately. it's Einstein. People just thought, oh, my God, over my head. General relativity and all that. But the classic phrase is, let the neck be free, to let the head go forward and up, to let the back lengthen and widen. And everyone goes, head forward and up. And it creates what we call Alexandroids, because everyone's walking around, I had Alexander lessons. I'm like, Jesus Christ, look at you. What are you doing to yourself? It's quite obviously really unnatural. It's actually an interference pattern. You've actually taken yourself away from your natural function and interfered with it. The most important word in that phrase is let. Let the neck be free. So let the head go forward and up. So let back length go widen. And it's a good reminder of what not to do. It's not a reminder of something to do. It's a reminder of what not to do. It's a reminder of not to pull your head, what we call back and down, with tightening. So you mentioned it, you know, your head was like that. It's not because it was a reaction. Your head could be in any position. It's fine if it's done freely. It's only a problem if you're doing this because it's part of a reaction. You know, the startle reflex. You go, ugh. Well, our stress response is the same. And when you're playing your bass and it's hard and you've got an audience and you've got stage fright, and that happens. The shoulders go up and the head goes back and down that way.
Turtleneck.
Exactly. And we're basically saying with head forward and up is a reminder not to do that. And say, actually, if I don't do that, things function, you know, if I recognize that interference, it's a great, simple window in and barometer of what's going on with you as a whole. Because if you've interfered here, you've probably interfered all sorts of places. But if you can come off this, we generally find there's a physiological response without, because this is not just a physical thing. It's a psychophysical thing. So when you choose to not do that, the nervous system responds.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
it's very difficult in some ways. You know, maybe we're like psychotherapists, but instead of talking to people, we talk through the body to get to people's thinking and their nervous system.
Yeah, I got
because
that
it's
from martial arts, for example. Just that confidence that makes you walk in a different way and look around
notice,
in a different way.
I
not
did
off like, oh no, I'm not looking into your eyes. Somebody might be looking back.
That actually was my greatest learning moment in my whole Alexander journey. It was sometime my second or third year of training. I was on the tube. I live in London. I was on the underground. I was on my way home from lunch. And I was sat there just looking around, minding my own business. And someone opposite me noticed that I was kind of very up and out and sort of thought I was maybe looking at them. They were probably a bit paranoid. So they looked at me. Then I realized someone's looking at me. So I looked back. I just looked them in the eye. smiled, nodded. And I went, I can't believe I just did that. Because normally, especially if you're British, I'm like, oh! So all the posture stuff that people talk about the Alexander Technique, that was far more valuable to me than anything. Just to be able to meet someone, a stranger, eye to eye, and feel nothing. And just acknowledge it. It was a wonderful moment for me. The same you were saying with your martial arts. And I did notice you do sit with good poise, you know. So that's where that comes from.
I don't think so. Because I probably wouldn't have such problems with my arms playing bass during my studies. That was all post-martial arts.
Oh, okay.
I mean, it was the everyday walking around. But when I got to practicing, I had a completely... And that we definitely need to talk about next.
Well, you changed your thinking. That's why. What you need to do is you need to bring your martial arts thinking into your bass playing.
Actually, let me mention the point before we forget it. I want to ask you to give us a definition, what the difference is between relaxing versus collapsing, because that was my pitfall. I thought being relaxed was this, or I wasn't aware that how I thought I'm being relaxed while I play was actually me being collapsed. In a collapsed state. But before we go on with that, there is one question from the audience. I'm not sure if you switched in a little bit late, because she asked for a definition of the Alexander Technique. You already explained it in the very beginning, but maybe you have a one sentence, max two sentence definition, just so we can get everyone on the same train.
Well, I kind of want to repeat what I already said if she missed it, but I'll say something else first. If I was to try to give a layman's succinct answer to that, I would say something like it's a form of embodied mindfulness, which gets you in the right ballpark. As I wrote in the book, as a footnote, I believe, my profession has a slight issue with that phrase, because there's an implication that you can maybe have disembodied mindfulness, which, because of psychophysicality, we don't think.
Yeah.
You can't have a mind without a body. It's a singular functional entity. So obviously all mindfulness has to be embodied. But that's maybe being pedantic. So maybe, embodied mindfulness. What Alexander said of his own work was it was dealing with the stimulus of living from a psychophysical construct.
There you have it. I have one more question, and basically it's a little side note to get to one of my favorite topics in the book, which is correct sitting. You're talking about when we sit, we actually stand on our hip bones.
Sit bones.
And we can walk on them, and that naturally brings our spine, neck, and in particular...
It's much better to find poise through movements than trying to find a position, because there is no position.
Yeah.
There's only skill.
Do you have a similar exercise to get the head up and forward quality of movement?
It's very difficult to be very succinct about this stuff in simple exercises, because they're experiences. Yeah. And a lot of it's context-based, understanding some context. All right, let me just start with the way the head balances on top of the spine anyway. Because that's a useful, practical place to start. And, you know, this is holistic work, but you need somewhere to start from. I don't know if any of you are C++ or JavaScript programmers, but I used to work in IT. We need a class to start from. This isn't like top-down style programming. It all interlinks, but you need a useful starting place. So although this is work is really about thinking, despite it being obviously psychophysical, So the physical is there. I start with some simple anatomy for a framework, a useful framework. So the human skeleton is completely unstable and it can't stand up, which might sound like a strange thing, but you've never seen the human skeleton stand up. You never will, unless it's hung from a hook from its head, or worse still, a rod up its backside. It's completely unstable. And good, thankfully, because there's a trade-off between stability and mobility. If you want to be stable, be a tortoise. If you want the fantastic mobility we've got, you're going to be unstable. And that's what we've gone with. I'm happy with it. I'm like my mobility. But what that mobility means is even standing is an activity, and standing itself is a movement activity. So you don't ever hold a position. You always wobble around an idealized plumb line. So you see those pictures in magazines with that awful alliteration of perfect posture. How many articles have I seen with perfect posture? And they always draw that, have this image of someone with perfect posture, with a plumb line drawn from ear, shoulder, hip, knee, ankle, as a straight line. And people seem to think you're supposed to achieve that line. Now, I have no problem with the picture itself. I have a problem with the text that goes with it and what it encourages people to think. You're not supposed to achieve the plumb line. That's simply the average of all the points you've wobbled about, and you may do it very skillfully, but the movement's always there. So there's always that little dance going on. So we've got ankles, knees, hips, and then all the vertebrae, and then this 5 kilograms of weight of the head on top, so that, you know, we're top heavy. And it's completely unstable already, and, you know, all these joints. But the way it works is your head balances on top of your spine. Let me just move my headphones a bit. This little gap under here, just below your earlobe, if you stick your fingers there, if you can feel it for yourself, that is the top of your spine through there. That's the axis over which you do that. Moving this way is actually between the first and second vertebra. So that's actually a spine movement, not a head movement. But that's the atlanto-occipital joint through there. It's kind of level with the underside of your nose. So your jaw is obviously an appendage. You can take it off and your skull will still sit at the top of your spine. Now, the interesting thing about that joint is ever so slightly to the rear. So if this is your head and this is your spine, let's just say this is my nose. If I exaggerate, if I put the joint right there, it's going to nod forward. It's going to balance. It's going to fall forward, isn't it? And as it does that, because you've got muscles that along the neck here, as the head rolls forward there, through gravity wanting it to roll forward off that joint, you get length up the back of the neck. And that generates length up the whole upper back. And that's just neutral gear. That's just a good general coordination. Of course, I could still look up around and do other stuff. There's no position you're supposed to be in. It's more of an issue. This is neutral gear. This is home. It's always debatable how long you spend at home. The issue isn't, you know, how long you spend at home. It's, can you freely return to it? And do you even know where home is? That's more of the question. So, you know, I could be here looking at something for quite some time, but actually it gets tiring after a while. I don't know what I'm looking at. Maybe it's clouds or something. It's nice architecture. But it does get tiring with the head off balance, and I start to feel it in my neck and shoulders. And that's the point where I go, well, that's enough. But a lot of people aren't doing that. They're permanently pulled like that. Permanently. And they've lowered their gaze,
right,
which feels very psychologically quite nice, because the eyelids come down. We're kind of shut behind there. But, you know, a lot of people are slightly looking up. They don't realize it, but they're permanently pulled there. And the muscles are strong, in fairness. So, you know, a day or two is no big deal, but day in, day out, week in, week out, month in, month out, year in, year out, decade in, decade out, it really starts to take a toll. And of course, the thing is, once this is tense, these muscles, there's a lot of fast twitch fibers in there, so it moves quickly for balance. But if it's all stiff because it's held here, because you're pulling your head back and it's not on balance, and it has to kind of just stay there, everything below has to compensate. And again, for a few moments, no big deal. But for a lifetime, it does add up. It's like a war of attrition. It's the death of a thousand cuts, you know. So if you know that, this head forward and up is really a reminder not to be pulling down there, that your spine and your neck is part of your spine, not a separate thing. We tend to call body parts separately so we can talk about them, but they're really all one thing. So, you know, my lower back is all part of my upper back. You know, it's all that spine is one functioning whole. So my spine stays back generally, you know, in neutral gear home, and the head rotates forward over it. So this when I say, so the head, it's a phrase that confuses people, head forward and up, up, up's up, but forward, people think forward's there. Well, no, that's not what you mean. The forward is the rotation forward.
That's exactly where I kind of saw a danger of misinterpretation. It's like, forward and up, you
it's
don't
language.
Mean this, do you?
Well, that's why we so often in lessons, on one-to-one lessons, work with our hands and just guide people through movement so we can bypass language. I mean, personally, I teach online, and Alexander started his teaching by teaching verbally. And he got so fed up with people misunderstanding them. He was like, no, not like that, like this. It probably felt horrible the first time he grabbed someone by the neck. But he refined it beautifully. And then he kind of stopped verbally explaining stuff, and he would just give people an experience to moving freely. Just, which isn't a great experience, but I think the problem is people don't understand the context. I think both together are good. And having read Alexander's books, I think there's an element that actually he just wasn't brilliant as a verbal communicator, which is ironic because, you know, he wanted to be an actor. He wasn't great. He communicated other people, Shakespeare's words well, but he couldn't communicate his own thoughts very well. And I've had to learn how to really do that through teaching online. And it's an issue. And sometimes you have to change your language. And I frequently do change my language, so it's away from our technical jargon for that reason. I'll use everyday language. And sometimes I'll say something and you can see it in someone's face, like, I've lost them. I've got to find other language. So there's no correct. So head forward and up, like I said, isn't a catechism. And I think there was a time, you know, say 30, 40 years ago, it was believed if you just said head forward and up enough, something magical would happen. Like, why? It doesn't. And if, you know, you're teaching in Japanese, you know, how does that help? So, yeah, you're right. You've got to be very careful how people interpret things because communication is a stimulus. It's tricky. And how's someone going to respond to it? So that's why teaching is the real art form. It's not a science. I would say the Alexander technique is very much an art form rather than a science. And we get ourselves into some tricky situations sometimes because we do have very good clinical outcomes with things. So people want to study what we do and turn it into a science. I'm like, yeah, but living isn't a science.
Is it?
And then we, you know, it's an art. Living's an art. Even making a cup of tea is an art form. That's why they have the tea ceremony in Japan. So, you know, we get find ourselves in positions where we're working with medics and we're kind of across. I mean, they can see, you know, the studies into back pain, for example, they can see it's beneficial and people aren't getting back pain because they've had Alexander lessons. And they want us to fit into their model of thinking.
Yeah, obviously. Makes it easier.
And I'm saying, well, and I'm thinking, actually, maybe you should fit to our model of thinking. Maybe that's the problem. It's not us that needs to change. Yeah, so teaching is an art form. Using yourself is an art form. Behavior is an art form. I would say the Alexander technique is really about exploring, learning about your behavior. Behavior psychophysical. But knowing where your support is makes behavior easier. Makes standing easier. Having good posture is so much easier than having bad posture. Bad posture is honestly a waste of energy. And the only reason people say they find it easier is Stockholm syndrome. They've been doing it for longer. So it's a habit. So it feels right to them. It psychologically feels right to them. And you will always defend what feels right to you. Yeah. And then you say, but my back really aches and it's sore. But I thought you told me that was easier. How can something that's easier ache and sore and be tight? That's not easier. So
nothing new is easy, is it?
So it's really the thinking that's hard to take away from the habit of, you know, if you're always here and, you know, you're used to just sitting like this, and then you say, oh, be here. Like, but the habit says be here. What you're really having to say no to is a feeling of association of correctness, because it's familiar.
Wow.
Just because it's familiar.
One thing that I think it was in your book as well, with releasing your chest into the width, about breathing, that I also found very, very useful. Where it's really, if you want to find a healthy position, just take a really deep breath, because you can't help but...
I don't like deep breaths.
You don't like deep breaths?
No.
Tell us why.
Firstly, it's fine. It depends what you use them for. If you're about to dive underwater, definitely take a deep breath.
Although maybe not too deep. Otherwise,
you float. Too buoyant. Yeah. It's context. So deep breaths for relaxation. We didn't answer your relaxation question, relaxation collapse. To answer that earlier question very quickly, as a profession, dislike the word relaxation because people associate it with collapse. Oh, I'm relaxed.
Yeah.
Well, you just collapse and other muscles are probably now overworking. So you're actually less relaxed than you were before, really.
Yeah.
Some parts might be more relaxed, others less, but you're collapsed. My simple answer to that question is, what's relaxed running like? You can have good running form and run in a relaxed manner with good form and poise, but in a relaxed manner.
Yeah.
So you're using the appropriate amount of muscle usage for the task and no more. So it's efficient and that's relaxed. That answers that question. Sorry, I had to bring that one back in. Now, you've kind of brought two separate things together. The width across the chest is more to do with the shoulders than breathing. So let me just quickly do that and then I'll get to the breathing. So we often obviously all pull our shoulders forward, and a typical postural thing is, when they say correct your posture, it's pull your shoulders back. And in fact, I have been replying the last 2 days on Instagram. I keep getting pleading annoying adverts from these posture correctors, or these things that strap you in and pull your shoulders back.
Oh yeah,
and it's annoying me so much. I'm replying to them saying, why is reducing mobility a good thing? This is awful. This is fascism.
But it looks good.
This is imposition. You're imposing on my natural mobility, my ability to move and balance, because posture is a balancing act. And you've just fixed something in a place. And if I wanted to be stable, it'd be a tortoise, damn it. that advice to pull the shoulders back doesn't work, because you're trying to use the opposite thinking that created the problem in the first place. If the problem is too much tension this way, the solution isn't too much tension that way, which is why no one ever keeps it. It's advice. A lot of this advice is given over and over again because it doesn't work, which means they could keep repeating it. Because if it worked, no one would need the advice. It would just be a known thing, like, duh. It's illogical to solve a problem with the opposite problem. So your shoulders hang there quite happily. And this is one place where I have to use Newtonian phrases, just because it's easier on the English language. And we haven't talked about gravity yet, so you probably won't notice why this is causing me to some emotional pain. But the weight of your arms is enough to pull your shoulder blades down the back. Oh, there, I said it. It's not true, but you'll go with it for now. It's fine. You're not used to the weight. You're so used to the weight of your own arms, you don't notice them. It's like wallpaper. Interestingly, if you have a couple of light things in your hands, if you've got light shopping bags, not something too heavy, but you can feel that pulling down the back, and it's kind of nice. If you're wide across the front,
So
to get your shoulders to go back and down, which is where they'll just be, because that's how we're evolved to take advantage of our environment, gravity, if you stop that narrowing in, which we do for all sorts of reasons, and it's not wrong in itself, you know, you get that awful news, that emotional news that just makes you curl up and, oh, what a shit piece of news that was. Excuse my French. but, you know, it's human. It's okay. It's a problem if you're there all the time.
Yeah.
You'll notice it. And it's an exercise I say. It's probably the first exercise in the book. And if I ever get a chance to do a second edition, I've decided there are some things in the book that are kind of exercises without me actually labeling them as exercises. It might be good to have a box saying this is effective. An exercise. And I said, let's just sit there with maybe your bass on a stand and just sit and through the, you know, what I've explained in the book, how to have poise and just be there in gravity, which we can cover again later. And what happens if we bring it in and put it there? Now, what I do, because I started off with classical guitar years ago, I've got one of these. I actually very rarely use this thing anymore. It depends on how good the strap is or how heavy the guitar is. I set the strap so it's same height as my left leg raised on a footstand. But I don't actually need, I take my foot off the footstand, it's still there. So if I want to, I can take it, support a little bit of weight on my leg, and the strap's there, which is nice because it then stops it falling over. But it means it's in the same place when I stand up. So I'm always playing in the same position. So, and there's nothing wrong with playing like that, by the way. Female classical guitarists do because of skirts, but they always play in the same position. So it's not that I'm pedantic that things have to be in the correct position. There are places where it's more useful than others. But the point is, at least be consistent. So if you always play sat down, maybe it doesn't matter you're always here. You know, James Jameson in the studio for God knows how many hours a day, he's always there. This is just his day job. He's always like this. And maybe that's fine. Because actually, when he's on a gig, half the time he's playing double bass anyway in some jazz club. He's doing something completely different. But I do that. Now, what a lot of people do, simply by having that there, and who was it? Was it Jake Wilson? I'm trying to think. There's a guitar player. I was doing a workshop with my publisher, Luke, a while back. And they made a really good observation. Just looking at their instrument, they could feel these muscles go in. Just a mere association makes you, because you're so used to sort of being around and we kind of cuddle it. We hug our instrument and we kind of, and that association is so strong. This guy and I think it was Jake, doesn't really matter, but he was honest enough to say, and it was a great, fantastic observation, the mere sight of his guitar was enough to notice that he wanted to pull in across the front. Because the association, it becomes Pavlovian, doesn't it? You know what I mean by Pavlov, by the way, don't you? Yeah. Well, Pavlov was the guy that, I can't remember, was it, he associated bell rings with food, with dogs.
Yeah.
So that after a while, all he had to do was ring a bell and they would salivate. And that's a Pavlovian response. It's learnt behavior. And you can sit here and say, can I just sit here and let it be there and have zero attitude towards it? I'm just here minding my own business. This is irrelevant. It's an inanimate object. It doesn't do anything. You can watch it all day. You know, you can look at it all day learning it. You can learn all about its geometry and all sorts of things, but until you do something, it's pretty useless. So you're not really learning the bass at all. You're learning yourself in relation to it. And can you just sit here without that feeling compromised by this inanimate object? And if you can free into width there, it's the width you want across, releasing, it's all the letting go, having the natural length of muscles, the shoulders will then hang down the back. And you don't have to pull them back, it's just where they are, you know, you don't have to do anything. Honestly, I'm far too lazy to ever posture myself or do anything correctly. I'm just not of that mind. I like to be efficient, economical, lazy. So as far as I'm concerned, good use, good behavior, good use. We say use in the Alexander technique, the way you use yourself. And we say use affects function, the way you use yourself affects your functioning. But good use is really quite lazy. But I say lazy in a physical way, but mentally there's a presence, there's a real keenness of mind. Alexander talked about quickening of the conscious mind. So yes, it's physically economical, lazy, but there is a presence of mind that's required. You can't be brain dead with it, because if you're brain dead, you'll see it in people's posture when they're brain dead. You see it in your own posture and behavior when you're tired. You're brain dead because you're tired. That's perfectly normal and perfectly acceptable. At least recognize it and get some rest, you know. So it's that width across the chest that allows the shoulder blades to hang down the back. And then you say, can I be here and not compromise that? And keep that nice width as you then pluck a note, as you then finger a note. Can you stay uninterfered with by the instrument? Now, the breathing thing, why don't I like deep breaths? Well, they are useful, certainly. Gearing up for major activity. Sorry, is that kind of all over? But what they do is they kick in your sympathetic nervous system. So you take lots of deep breaths, you're gearing yourself up for activity. So when someone says, calm down, relax, take some nice deep breaths, complete oxymoron.
Can I answer something? From what I've heard, if we activate the parasympathetic or the sympathetic nervous system, it depends on the ratio of in and out breaths. So as long as the out breath is longer, you can take a deep breath in and still relax.
But I would argue we're so, because of the way we are with a stress response, we tend to hold the diaphragm down. So the diaphragm pulls down to create volume, and that's it being tense. And therefore, because we're all so stressed out and tense with modern life, it's one of those muscles that just stays pulled down. So people are effectively breathing on top of a pre-breath. And encouraging people to do deep in-breaths, they're already too good at them. Now, when people say, I'm short of breath, I'm having a panic attack, I'm short of breath, you're not short of breath. You've got so much of it, there's none left. Let some out first. Which is why there used to be the old advice to blow into a bag, which actually they don't, I've discovered, anymore, because of they would then breathe in through the bag as well. And obviously you've just blown out a load of carbon dioxide, so you certainly don't want to breathe that back in. It's not that hard to say, though, breathe into it, blow out, breathe. Anyway, but basically my advice is nice long out breath. So the only thing you can do with your breath is interfere with it. That's the only thing you can do with your breath, interfere with it.
But you can do
Well,
it
allow
consciously or
yourself,
unconsciously.
you can allow yourself to be breathed. And you can interfere with it consciously, constructively. Otherwise, how else would we talk and sing? But we're usually too good at the in-breath. And to get the diaphragm to release fully, nice long out-breaths, because then the diaphragm releases. And it's the out-breath that's really encouraging the parasympathetic. Like I say, it is the ratio, but I would ignore the in-breath, because you're going to be breathed in anyway. It's going to happen. Yeah, I promise you'll breathe back in.
It's actually really hard to keep breath out, way harder than to keep it in.
So I encourage nice long out breaths, pause, and then it takes effort to keep the air out. Recognize that tension as the rib cages come in. And then as you release, rib cage will hopefully ping out. And it's interesting, what is breathing? I tell you what, it's got nothing to do with this. Nothing at all to do with your mouth and your nose. It's to do with movement of the torso. And when I say the torso, not just the rib cage, as a byproduct that the spine wobbles with it because the rib cage articulates with the spine, the diaphragm attaches to the spine as well. So when you breathe, there's a little sort of snake-like wave that goes through the spine, front to back.
My wife which is even why you... says she can crack her back by breathing.
Now, people put their back out from you know, having, from sneezing.
Oh, yeah, true.
So, yeah, nice long out-breaths really encourage the parasympathetic system, which calms you down, which part of self-regulation means you're less reactive, but it also means your muscle tone's lighter, so you're not so tense. So instead of working directly through muscles, if you work on your thinking and the quality of your nervous system, you can influence the quality of your muscles because, you know, they're all the same thing. And long out-breaths are just a practical way of doing that,
yeah,
of lowering the tone of your nervous system so you can become more present. So you do a nice long out-breath and then just let yourself be breathed in. You know, you don't have to actively breathe in. It will just come. You know? And that's an interesting exercise in its own right for while you're playing, for while you're practicing. A lot of people will hold their breath while playing, particularly when they get into the complicated bit. It comes and they hold the breath. Of course, they're not just holding their breath, really, they hold all of themselves. Your entire being gets rigid as you hold your breath. The breath is kind of really in that moment. You're not really just holding your breath, you're holding yourself entirely. Then of course you can't perform because and then you've made that difficult thing even harder. So what I recommend is you get people to learn to divorce their playing from their breath.
That would have been my next question because I have this vague memory of like one of the top guys, bass players, saying. Might even have been Victor Wooten, I'm not sure, but it was some of those guys, one of those guys who said to breathe with the music. So obviously not to interrupt it and hold the breath, but to basically, like you would when you talk, because you're breathing with your words. You have to
breathed. You will be breathed. And if you're running around doing
will music not? But that's the whole concept. It probably was Victor Wooten, now that I think of it.
So if you're playing a piece of music,
he has this idea of music being channeled through you. The music plays you.
Yes. Yeah. So if let's just say you're playing something very energetic music, your nervous system is in a more energetic rate. Your breathing will be in a more energetic rate. Your breathing will just reflect. What's going on? Yeah. Your engagement. So you let it breathe faster and deeper. But let's say you're playing some very mellow, quiet stuff and your nervous system drops and your emotional state's quiet with it. Your breathing will get shallower and slower with it. It will change. And your only job is to let it.
Yeah.
So yeah, your entire behavior, including breath, will ebb and flow with your behavior, which therefore means with the music as well. But as an exercise to teach people to divorce their breath from their playing, I get people to set a metronome, play something they can find really easy. It can just be a scale or some chords, but it doesn't really matter what it is. But
let's do this live as an experiment.
So
let me grab a metronome.
Because what often happens is people's timing goes a bit funny with this exercise. And the exercise in part is to not lose being right on top of it with your rhythm playing with the breath exercise. Because a lot of people will find that during they're allowing the in-breath, their timing goes a bit funny. And that's part of the exercise to learn to divorce what you're doing with the instrument from your reactive breath.
Yeah. Shall we try it out?
Yeah, give it a go. Now, I'm going to have a quick kick back for a moment because I do have the back of the chair. There is nothing wrong with reclining.
Tell me one more time what exactly the exercise is so everyone else maybe can even grab the bass and do it by themselves. Check it out.
Yeah, to your click track, though, because I might get a bit distracted otherwise. Although I'll have to turn the sound off. And so basically, you're going to set a metronome going up, some sort of, nothing too fancy. This isn't about trying to learn to play fast or anything. But you're just going to play something, just maybe, you know, an octave scale or an octave and an extra one so it fits in rhythmically with eighth notes. Because it's a seven-note scale, which is annoying. If you want, get around that, play the bebop scale. There you go, then you'll always be on it. But it doesn't really matter what you play. But it may as well be a scale, why not? Or maybe it's just plunking away on your low E or low B, whatever you have. And you play on it all the time, just getting this rhythm solid. But the exercise is you take a nice long out breath, pause, and release. And then you will be breathed in, and in its own time, the in-breath will come, and it will eventually turn itself into an out-breath. You don't need to do anything. It'll happen, just as it does in your sleep.
Yeah.
And once, I could refine this further, I'm not going to now. For now, once you find yourself being breathed out, you can join in and do a long out-breath until you can't breathe any more air out. So you really extend it till you've got no air left. Pause. And then just let go. One of the nice things about that, by the way, is not only does it get the diaphragm to release nicely, it really gets frees up the rib cage. So in its own way, it's a reset for the breathing mechanism. So you've got your full breathing functionality nice and free again. It's a bit like turn a computer off and back on to get rid of a glitch. These long out breaths and release are kind of the equivalent for breathing. So you can either do 3 to 5 of those to reset your breathing, or you could do them for a minute or two to keep working on your parasympathetic as well.
Okay, let me try that out. Everyone else who's watching, come and join me. So I have my
just before you start, I've done this exercise with other people before who are rather good players. And it can be difficult for the audience to appreciate that their timing is going. Because it sounds good enough to us. I want you to be honest to go, actually, I can feel I'm really slightly dragging there.
Yeah.
So I want you to report back to us what your experience is.
Okay, I'm not going to ask any further questions. I'm just going to try. And you're going to give me feedback if I even did what you asked. And I'll tell you how it felt to me. Gonna let you rest and go on single screen. I'm gonna leave on the microphone so you can hear the metronome, hopefully. So this is set to 60 BPM, which I think Adrian suggests to set your metronome to in the book. To be really honest, I find 60 is on the border of being very slow to concentrate and play in time. So maybe if you're not an advanced player, start with 80. This way it's easier to be more right on the point because the gaps in between the clicks are not so big. Anyhow, so I'm just going to play a scale over. Hang on, first things first, don't flat, don't be a bass. See, there we go.
Straight away.
Yeah, I haven't even put my fingers on the bass. Okay, let's try that. Now I'm slipping into micromanaging everything. But let's see how this works out. So here we go. I'm going to play an Aeolian scale, just over one octave, 3 notes per string. So that's enough to fill a 2 bars.
in breath, isn't it, when it comes? Actually, you made your life difficult there by playing so slowly, but it was actually very helpful from my perspective.
Yeah.
It was much easier to hear the drift.
Yeah. I could definitely feel it. And I could also feel I was putting a lot more focus on the in-breath than the out-breath. Although, before I started, I decided not to. But it's way more easy to focus on the in-breath and go until it can't anymore than focusing on breathing out as far as you can.
Don't forget, the in-breath is doing you. You're not doing anything at that point.
Yeah. Yeah, but I think at least now in this exercise, I kept breathing in when the natural breath would have already been...
You were interfering with the in-breath.
Exactly.
Yeah, and that's part of the exercise. We tend to say procedure rather than exercise because it's a method of exploring rather than getting right. But yeah, and you saw how your timing went awry with it.
Absolutely.
So it's a really useful one to just learn to divorce your breathing from your playing. And then that way, you're much less likely, when you get that difficult part, to hold your breath. Right. And if anything, and it still happens, of course, you know, I'm not saying you always get brilliant at it because a new piece of music comes along, a new technique, and, you know, you have to learn to juggle all these things again. But if in doubt, breathe out.
Yeah, that's a good one. Also, one more thing about what I've experienced now is how do I put it? I really felt inclined to breathe out until I reached the top note.
Because you were trying to time it.
And I started to being frustrated on the second round that I had no more breath left. And I had to breathe in when I was on the fifth note already.
Yeah, no, the two are completely unrelated. Yeah. Completely unrelated. I mean, there are players that will effectively scat while they solo, particularly jazzers.
Yeah.
And it
or
can be
saxophone players, singers.
Well, the thing is, singers, yes. Saxophone players, no. But I've heard quite a few guitar players mention sax as an example of why you'd want to do that for better phrasing. And then I go, have you not heard of circular breathing? Why do you think sax players invented circular breathing?
So they don't have to stop.
So sax players can do what guitar players are really guilty of.
True. I never really thought about that.
I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, I suppose, you know, and it is a way to naturally, because singing is a great way to phrase, obviously.
Yeah.
And to, you know, if you're an instrumentalist, we love hearing that kind of natural phrasing related to voice. I don't think it has to be. They are different things, but it's nice to incorporate that if you want to. And it's a way, but you need to be able to do it in a way that's not an interference as well.
Yeah.
You shouldn't need to have to do it, you know. So I'm not saying don't do it. I'm not saying don't do it.
Yeah. We're circling back to giving up control being the way to gain control.
Yeah. 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 Maddening, though. it's not an easy psychology.
No, it definitely isn't.
Because of a word you used earlier, end gaining, the phrase that, an Alexander phrase, which means to go for the end result without consideration of how you're going to achieve it. And an example would be, or the opposite of that, in Zen archery, Kyoto, which is marked at competition level, you get no marks for hitting the bullseye. You get no marks for hitting the target at all. In fact, they stop marking you all together the moment you let go of the arrow. Because if all the preconditions were there, the end results are given.
Yeah.
So if you consider the process of forget about the results. If you consider the process, the end result will do itself. But we're all, the psychology of all of us is we're all inveterate end gainers. And we lose sight of ourselves in activity going for the end result, losing sight of how we're actually going to achieve the result in the first place.
Would you think that there is also an
That's classic Alexander, though.
An unhealthy opposite extreme? Because what I described myself as a control freak earlier,
interesting question.
I feel like that is the extreme opposite sometimes, that you get lost in the process where you're never moving forward because you're just diving deeper and deeper into every little detail, micromanaging, where you can't even take another step before.
This is interesting. I quite like that, actually. It's another form of end gaining. So a word I haven't used yet is inhibition. And I said earlier, I sometimes don't use our own technical jargon for various reasons. And the reason I often don't use inhibition, which is basically be cool as a cucumber and non-reactive, and it's central to the Alexander technique, it's that quality of mind, that quality I spoke about at the beginning that someone might have in yoga or in Tai Chi, that sense of presence and non-reactivity and flow in movement. And I don't use the word simply because Sigmund Freud has kind of ruined the word for us. So for him, it was very much about repression. And so people tend to hear the word as that. So I tend to not use the word inhibition because colloquially people don't respond to it well. But the word is inhibition anyway. And it's impossible to end gain your inhibition. You end gain your ability. You so focus on not trying to react that you end up actually being repressed rather than just free. And it's a really insidious psychology. And I was giving a talk a couple of years ago to some colleagues. I was one of the early adopters of teaching online during lockdown. I mean, some of my other colleagues had been doing it for years more, but with lockdown, we were left with no choice. And I seemed to take to it like a duck to water for whatever reason. So I was giving a talk to some of my colleagues on how to teach online, because we're not taught that way. We're taught to do a hands-on guidance thing. And I said to them at the end, be honest, guys, I've got a question for you. How often do you find you end gain your inhibition? And all I got back as a reply was nervous laughter, which implies that Alexander Technique teachers are the worst people for this. They're so obsessed with inhibiting, you can end gain it, and it turns up into repression. And I think the same could be true of the means whereby. You get so caught up end gain the means whereby, you forget why you're even doing the means in the first place. So end gaining doesn't mean not having a desired end result. I think that's something, I mean, you can get, I don't like talking about these things sometimes because people get hung up on the language and the meaning behind it and go, oh, you know, how would you get anything done otherwise? Well, obviously you have an intention. Your intention still matters. Your intention is everything. So your question was, can you end gain the means whereby, the process, so that you lose sight of your intention? Yes, I think you can. I think that's something we're capable of doing as human beings and our psychology. Can you lose sight of your intention is basically your question. Yes, we can.
Well, I reckon micromanaging is one of the symptoms of it.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So I've just looked at the time for the first time. We are already 95 minutes in.
I did warn you.
Yeah. So I don't want your kids to stay up too late, but I would like to do one more practical thing.
Okay. Yeah. Because you want to play something.
I want to play something.
And I want you to play something. And we all want you to play something. Because I'm assuming all of us here have heard you play. And like, yeah, that's something worth being here for. So. Oh man, I didn't discuss gravity. Just to get the gravity thing out of the way, It doesn't. I just go away after this or tomorrow. Go on YouTube and look up, is gravity a force? That's the phrase. And what you'll discover is the acceleration of the Earth is up underneath you. And I know that's weird because you think, why aren't I moving? Just go and, because you think there's acceleration, there has to be movement. Why am I moving upwards? I could go into a long discussion about it. I particularly like the Veritasium Science Channel. They've got a nice one on this, but there's a number of them. What's your view of them? It's basically general relativity. Einstein's general relativity. What you want to be thinking of is if you were on an if you're in interstellar space and there was a surface accelerating under your feet at 9.8 meters per second squared, and there's no gravity because there's no massive objects, there's just this small object accelerating underneath you, that would be indistinguishable from the experience you're having now. And so the thinking is, from a pedagogical point of view, in terms of your posture and your poise, is do you want to be thinking gravity's pulling me down? Or do you want to be thinking gravity's an upthrust, which I'm surfing?
Yeah.
And it is that, which is why you always need to move. There's no position. You're surfing an upthrust. And because you're so unstable, and all it has to do is move an arm and you've redistributed, you know, where everything's going, the center of gravity, you're always dancing around this. So there is no position. Being upright is a movement activity. And what makes sitting harder than standing is you're more stable because you've taken the ankles and knees out of the equation, so you're less wobbly. And I think that encourages us to be a bit stiff. Also, because your thinking is you're thinking down, and therefore you relax and collapse. Yeah. You don't sit down. You stand up on your bottom. Sitting and standing, the same thing for your torso. The same thing. And I've got a diagram of that in the book that shows that the sit bones and the hip joints are both below the sacroiliac joint. That's where the spine meets the pelvis. So that pelvic bowl, the spine coming out of it, is unchanged whether you're sitting or standing. Now, there's nothing wrong with reclining, but now you're at rest. Now I'm not doing something active. This is active. I'm standing my bum. Now I'm reclining in the back of my chair. I'm passive. They're different. Now, that's the gravity thing out of the way. You're using up thrust. You're dancing around it. Now, do this quick experiment with me. I want you to find your own, what I call, your fly-by-wire mechanism, which is a phrase I've stolen from the aerospace industry because I grew up on RAF military bases. My dad was in the Air Force. I grew up around planes. The fly-by-wire system is the system that stops a fighter jet falling out of the sky because it's so unstable, like us, so it could be more mobile because that's what the military want out of those jets. So they put an onboard computer on it sometime in the early 80s that allowed the computer to do the fine movement to stop it spinning out of control so the pilot could just do left, right, up, down. And in the same way, you've got your fly-by-wire system in the back of your brain there that basically does the not falling over. You don't try to not fall over. All good posture is not falling over with style. You're already not falling over. But the way you don't fall over is through movement. Because if you're not moving, you're holding. And holding is damn tiring. Whereas if you're moving, muscles are firing, releasing, firing, releasing, firing, releasing. That's much less tiring than holding permanently.
That reminds me of when I went to school and before I switched to riding my bike to school and went on the bus and on the train, I always enjoyed not holding on and rather trying to balance it out like that. Obviously,
I still do that on the
bus
tube.
Really
surf
had
the
to
tube.
Break that went sidewards. But other than that, that was always a great exercise.
I still do it on the tube. And there are some tube stops you can't do it because they break quite hard because it's a shorter platform. Anyway, so what you do is you close your eyes purposely to destabilize you. And this, by the way, is going to go in, this movement that we're going to play with here is going to play into rhythm and time feel.
Okay.
And that's when I'm going to ask you to play. So I want everyone to do this. Close your eyes. It destabilizes you because I want you to be more unstable. We use our eyes a lot for stability. For those of us that have grown up sighted, Interesting thing, by the way, the congenitally blind who've never had sight, they very rarely have bad posture. Because they're fully engaged in their environment in all directions. They're not generally pulled forward by sight because sound is a little more global. Because we get pulled forward by staring at computer screens. It's not the screen that's causing us any problem, it's our behavior towards it. And the same with an instrument as you look at your fretboard. If you don't have sight, you can't get pulled in that direction as a stimulus. So, assuming us we're all sighted here, when we close our eyes, we actually lose some stability. So, but I need you to watch me for a moment. So you have to open your eyes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to rock from side to side and create a nice S bend. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop moving intentionally, but not try to stop moving. I'm just going to stop the intentional movement. So if I stop now I'll keep wobbling. Quite quickly, I become more stable. You can still see I'm still wobbling. And it gets less and less. But that's my innate balance system righting itself. Now, if you get really good at this, you can get very so skilled at it that you lose sight of whether you're actually moving or not because you're so skilled at it. If in doubt, kick the pendulum off again. But you can get quite subtle there and recognize this tiny movement there all the time. But that is your posture. That movement is your posture. As you play around, allow the system to refine support. And it's just working it out. It's going, yeah, all right. And it's not trying to snatch and hold. It's just playing around, dancing with this up thrust. So give it a go. Just swing from side to side. You can sort of go from one sit bone, one buttock to the other. And then you stop moving intentionally, but just let the self-righting mechanism do its own thing. And that movement is your posture. You want movement. Even if it's subtle, even if it's small, the moment you think you're still completely, it may be for a moment that you're just really skillfully managed to. But breath itself is going to put a wave along there. There's always subtle movement there. I admit it can be hard to dial into it if you're not used to it.
Yeah.
But can you see, feel that your own self-righting mechanism, that is a movement pattern. That's movement. Your posture is movement. Now you've got a feel for that, maybe that you've got this thing that very fluid. You can play with it. Dolphins play with water. They love a good splash around. Do all sorts of crazy antics. We can play with our environment. They've got their aquatic environment. We've got our accelerating surface environment. We play with it. It supports us, and we can play with it. We can dance with it. We can have fun with it. Now, there's a phrase that I've struggled with for donkey's ears, which is good time feel. What the heck does that actually mean? Because you can't feel time. We have no time receptor. What we feel is change, because time is a measure of change. And what we recognize in good time feel is our own movement. Our movement is the change. So good time feel is actually good movement feel. So when you want to generate a groove, you have to feel it right physically in your torso. Now, some bass players are that classic John Entwistle. Don't move. I love the ox, mad. But I was about to go off a tangent. I won't. We're running short time.
it's actually one of the first questions that I ask any of my students. Are you a dancer? Do you like to dance to music?
Yeah, it's
If
a
they
good
say
question.
no, I know right away it's going to be more work on their timing.
Exactly. And you're absolutely right. It's a great observation. Good time feel is movement feel, and it doesn't have to be a big dance. And it depends on people's personality. So it's not like it has to be extrovert or anything, but it needs to be felt. So you've got this wobble, natural wobbliness, and with that, then you play with it. Now, I'm going to do something for its own sake that's visible on camera. Just so it's visible on camera. It doesn't have to be big, but I can be going, and I'm not moving a lot, but I'm generating rhythm. That is first, that is primary, and that must never go. Now, the first thing that's happening when you're doing that, not only are you generating good rhythm, you're keeping yourself free and mobile. If you're dancing, you're not stiff in your back and your spine and your shoulders. So by having good time fill through playing through your fly-by-wire system, as I call it, you're helping not only create good time, you're helping to free your body mechanics up to have much less muscle tension. So it's circular. They help each other.
Let me do.
So the exercise is this. The exercise is this. Play something, a groove, but just be really solid. Just don't move.
Yeah, I know the exact perfect groove for that one.
Try to hold a correct posture, whatever one of those is. Hold a correct posture and play the groove.
Just found my preset here. So this is a groove which has for a long time been hit and miss. And I think I've noticed that it has exactly to do with what you've just been talking about. If I move with it, or if I'm too much in my head and trying to do it correctly and gaining, basically. So, now I'm gonna leave the mic on. I hope there's no overdrive there from getting all that loud bass into the microphone. So this one, Sweet Home, from my debut record. I'm not gonna play the whole song now because we want to demonstrate something and I'm gonna do two different kinds, but it's basically a slap bass riff played over blues. So it's like this.
Observation, and I was like, and it's not criticism, it's an observation for the experiment.
Yeah,
it's lifeless.
Yeah, it wasn't totally off, but
no, I mean, it wasn't awful, it's music.
Yeah,
but we all know, I know, I can tell now. I hope the audience recognized there was something there that just lacking. Now, what I want you to do better. Now, I want you to start dancing to it. Now, your personality is yours. It has to be as big or small as you want. But that is primary. I do not care what happens afterwards. I do not care what you do with your hands, with your fingers. I have no interest in that whatsoever. I'm interested in you in genuinely feeling that groove in your body. And that is primary. All you have to do is keep that going. And out of that, it flows into your hands.
Okay.
So
let
that's probably
into the move.
Yeah. Feel that, and that is all that matters. The adding the hands is entirely secondary. Night and day, isn't it? I've got a question though.
Yeah.
When you enter the four chord,
Yep.
Did you feel like you lost it a bit in here?
Yeah.
Why?
Why? Because
you lost. You got distracted by moving the fret position, didn't you?
Absolutely. Quickly. Wait. I gotta open my eyes and make sure I'm landing on the right spot on the fretboard.
So, as I said, I didn't care what your hands are doing. I would rather you played the wrong note but kept the groove, and then you slid up. That's part of the experiment and the deal. So it was interesting. I observed that you lost the body part when you got distracted. But the body part's the only bit that actually matters in some respect. I mean, I could be over-egging this, but, you know, on a gig, someone might...
Might disagree.
That was a bum note. But the interesting thing is, if you do play a bum note, but it's in time and you just laugh, I'll tell you what, everyone's with you. Everyone's laughing with you, not at you, but with you. You know, and you're statistically going to make them play a bum note. You're never not going to not play a bum note. So I just thought it was interesting. I don't know if the audience noticed that slight change when we went into the four chord and he shifted position. It got a bit stilted for a moment because he lost sight of. So even though the desire there, the experiment was make the movement and the dance, whatever you want to call it, primary.
I think
how difficult it is to keep that primary. It's not easy.
I think I might have even held my breath for a little moment there.
Yeah, because it's a, and why? Because it's a reaction.
Yeah.
And when we react, we tighten and we get in the way. But yeah, we're going to do that with bits we're learning, with a piece of music we don't know so well. But that's what we work on. They're really good things. But the nice thing about it, not only are you learning to keep good time and understand what keeping good time is, you're freeing up your spine and your shoulders and your neck. You're letting music not give you backache and neckache and shoulder ache.
Yeah. I mean,
that ought to be the closing bookend phrase, really.
I keep having students, or maybe just people on con. Actually, I was on a birthday party not too long ago, and I didn't play, but there was a musician there, and I met another musician as well, who was there with her husband, and she was telling me about how she loves music and how her husband has no rhythm feel whatsoever. He's a DJ, but he has no rhythm feel. He cannot move. He cannot hold a rhythm. He cannot even clap to the beat. Ironically, he then was asked, with the musician who was performing at the night on the piano, to join him and just play random notes, why the pianist made them sound like music. So I got her there because I right away said, no, wait. There's not a single person in the world that does not have a feel for rhythm. If you don't have rhythm, then you have a problem with your heart. Then you cannot walk. You cannot pedal your bike. All of that has to happen.
There's a more serious aspect to this, though, to do with emotional states and trauma and, you know, some people don't have great rhythm because they're so stressed out. And it's built-in stress, and they can't move for psychological reasons, for emotional reasons. It can't express. They're too locked in.
Yeah. If you make them get up and run in a circle, that's generally quite
of course
rhythmical.
Walking of course is the rhythm itself, but the it's not they can't have rhythm, they struggle emotionally to express things like that.
Yeah.
And that needs to be honored, I think, that people can be in these states, not to sort of ridicule them, actually. Yeah. Who knows what someone's background is and why they're kind of...
No, absolutely.
But, yeah.
I still think that's something different than not having rhythm.
It's not being able to express it freely in a creative way.
Exactly.
Because what you're asking someone to do to create a rhythm is actually to communicate. And they might have communication issues at the end of the day.
Mm. Yeah.
And just on this theme of this exercise, there's two things you could do. Now, it's unlikely with bass players, I guess. Just the nature of the instrument, you'll be playing solo. Well, you obviously. yeah, oops. But commonly for bass players, I don't know what the audience's situation is. But it can be very difficult to say, if you're a solo player, to engage with the audience, and there feels this big gap between you and them. It's like, ooh, you know, how do you bridge that gap? And the best way to do it is through movement. And I did this, I experimented with this a few years back with one of my clients. That's why I ended up in the book. It sort of came out of conversations, ways to help with this. And it takes a bit of bravery. You don't necessarily want to do it every song. But I said, I want you to start grooving before you play a damn note, just as you did. But you're also not allowed to play a damn note until one person responds, just one, responds in kind. Now, if you're up on stage, open mic night, and let's say it is a bass, but most open mic nights is you're probably playing guitar or something, but it's the principle. And you're there going, and he was looking at you. How's he doing? Maybe someone's going to go, oh, yeah.
I can feel it too.
Now both of you are in unison. Now you're together. Now you can play it. Now you can start playing. In a more real, and it's a great way to knock down barriers between an audience and you. And it's a little game, you know, and it not saying you do it every song and or every gig even, but it's an interesting thing to try.
Yeah.
A great thing to try at rehearsals for a whole band, and this is more likely with you guys, even if it's just drum and bass, literally, two of you jamming. It's the rhythm section, but let the drummer lead. Even if he's a rubbish drummer, you've still got to... Sorry, did I say that? Yeah, the drummer does have to kind of be the king when it comes to laying down the groove. It ought to come from him. I say it ought to. It's never that simple. I mentioned the ox early, Ent whistle. Keith Moon actually followed Townsend, not the other way around, which is unusual. It's a bit like flamenco. So a guitar player in flamenco follows the dancers, not the other way around.
Yeah.
So the dancers create the rhythm, and then the flamenco guitarist plays off that. It's not like it's not the dancers playing, dancing to the guitar player in flamenco. It's the other way around. And with The Who, it was very similar. You sometimes see Townsend bash out some riff with his foot because he wanted to go in a new direction while they're improvising. And he'd be looking at Moon going, and he'd go, all right. Yeah, everything's all in the mix, and it's. But often, you know, we do look to the drummer to be the guide. So, for the sake of argument, we'll ask our drummer to do this. And he's not allowed to play a damn thing. And you're not allowed to play a damn thing. And then when all of you are looking eyeball to eyeball, go, oh yeah, we're so there. Then we're there. I'm with you. Yeah. I'm with you. Then the drummer counts off and in you go. And wow, you're locked in. And that's communication. And not only do you create good music and good vibe and good time, you're not being stiff. Because ultimately, people don't usually come to me as an Alexander teacher because I can show them good time film and be a better musician in that way. They come to me because they've got repetitive strain injuries and back pain and shoulder pain.
Yeah.
But that attitude helps you not develop those tension patterns. The music itself can guide you to not be stiff. Ah, and this is what I want to end with, since it's just come up. You need to do that in your practice. So that let's just say you're playing with a metronome. I actually stopped playing with a metronome for ages for a while because I was so enjoying just playing with this, I didn't need one anyway.
Yeah.
But if you can practice this just to a scale, particularly to a scale, because if you're playing a scale and got to learn our scales and they're boring, you're going to click, you end up like this, brain dead.
I've seen that face many times in my lessons.
That repeatedly, hours on end, weeks on end practice, leads to RSI and back pain and shoulder pain. But if you practice your scale, this is very much Victor Wooten thinking. If you're there just grooving, doesn't matter what note you play. But if you play your scale going, and it's just a scale up and down, but you are not practicing a scale. You are performing a scale. You are even performing music. And you know that thing people get, it says, oh, I can play this right when I practice, but when I play with people, I all goes wrong. It's because you're practicing one thing and then expecting to do something different on stage.
Yeah.
Because you're practicing this. And then you're going out going, like, well, hang on, where is everything?
And yet there are some people who also are on stage like this.
Yeah, but it's not, I mean, there's nothing wrong with that because we have different personalities and actually they could actually be feeling the groove. I mean, some people have very subtle nervous systems and that's maybe all they need. So it's not necessarily something you mark by the amount of movement. It's very individual to the person. But if you practice your scales always grooving through movement, through the dance, not only will you not develop aches and pains, you'll be practicing performance itself. So that when you perform, we've done that before because you every time you practice, you performed. And you're taking the same attitude. You're practicing the attitude it takes to play. In fact, you're not practicing at all. You're only ever playing. You're having a laugh. You know, who practices their Xbox? Who practices their Nintendo? They play it and get better at it. But it's at least knowing what the factors are that allow it to be fun.
Yeah.
So that when you and if you're moving and grooving, you're having fun. You need to not be self-conscious about it.
I have to get in there with an alternative perspective. Although I'm completely on your side when it comes, especially with younger kids, that play is learning. But I have the feeling that there is a time for practicing and a time for performance practice in your practice. That those are still different kind of things. Because just from the state of attention, I would say if when you're in a practicing state, you observe yourself, you give yourself critical feedback or constructive feedback.
Yeah, it's true.
And you stop yourself to fix a mistake, which is a problem for people that only practice this way and then on stage, they don't know why they can't get through a song in one go.
Both can be true, though, because if you're wanting to keep an eye on everything, one of the things you should be keeping an eye on is, are you interfering with yourself?
Yeah.
And obviously there's some practice we do that isn't to a tempo because it's a new finger and you're just learning a fingering and there is no tempo, there is no groove, and that's fine. You know, that's a form of practice that's going to be literally just looking at fingers going, why won't it go? You know, and learning geometry not everything one practices is to a tempo, and that's perfectly obviously acceptable and normal. But when there is a tempo involved, understand where the tempo is coming from, and what it offers you in return.
And on the other hand, as much as I was countering your argument to some degree, I do agree that even when we're focusing on improving our technique, stopping ourselves when we make a mistake that we need to fix to be able to perform it in a way that pleases ourselves and hopefully the audience as well, that doesn't mean we cannot groove with what we do, like whole body movement. And
it could, but I mean, I'm trying to think of a way of saying this from a bass perspective. It's easy for me to say it from a guitar perspective, just because I haven't played a lot of bass for like of late. But you, let's just say you've got a beginner, and the chord change is what they can get a groove on one chord, but then they've got to get to the next chord, and that's where it all falls apart. And of course, you might basically say, "All right, you're going to strum and groove for one bar, and then you're going to stop, and then you're going to find your new chord." And then carry on, and eventually you've got to learn to do it within the groove. You know, there, it's not. I don't mean to be rigid in this sort of idea. It's supposed to be a useful tool, not something to beat someone over the head with. Obviously,
Nothing
there are
to
lots
do
of.
correctly.
Yeah, exactly. exactly. Yeah, obviously, there are lots of different elements to learning and practicing. You know, when you're first learning a new piece of music, you're literally just learning the geometry of where everything has to go, remembering it. So what I'm saying really falls into the latter part of that learning process. Maybe you've got all the geometry remembered, and
Yeah,
you've maybe
I
got the
guess this
finger
whole
skill.
the freedom of bringing the body and let's just call it natural rhythm into the equation, to some degree always has to come after the theory or somewhat automating the movements to some degree. Because if we still
Yeah,
have
but
to focus on
bring it.
which finger goes where and synchronizing that with the other hand, there
Yeah,
is.
but if you can, it's a lot easier to make those synchronizations if you have the groove, though. They come together quite naturally, but it could be quite simple. You know, you could have an absolute beginner, absolute, can't play a note, so you just start on the open. I don't, you probably can't hear me because I'm not plugged in, but you could just be grooving on the open A string, E string, and you're just being, well, you know, just four notes for the bar. And if they can do that, you go, well, here we go. That's good. Now, let's say, for the sake of argument, I could just go from my E string to my A string. But let's just say I go to the fifth fret instead. Now he's got to do something with that hand. So he's got to bring a new coordination in. This is obviously incredibly basic, but can you just go from not lose that and now that? That actually might be a genuine baseline at the end of the day. There's no reason why it wouldn't be, given context. So you can bring it in right from the very beginning, right from the most simple stuff. But you're right, if you're then having to show it a full scale, you know, you're going to do some stuff without a tempo. There is no tempo practice, if you like to call it. That's a phrase I learned off classical guitarist Jamie Andreas. She talks about no tempo practice. Some of our practice does happen without a tempo, which is particularly when you're learning new fingerings, especially, you know.
Because they're new movements, and you have this whole chapter about sympathetic tension, which we're not going to go into, although I really wanted to, because this is a very interesting topic, I find, and I get asked questions about it by my students. But yeah, it's been, we've been at it for over 2 hours now.
And I promise you, we've barely scratched the
I know. Let me
surface.
just count through how many of the points that we sitting,
Human
standing, we talked
behavior.
about that behavior thinking, not really. Reaction tension, I guess we mixed it in there. General functioning disabled by playing bass. Not really. Finger exercise, put string to the crown of fret. We did not do that.
And that's
Always
part of the.
practice coordination before strength. We not did not go into that. Can you leave yourself alone? We did, I guess we
Kind of.
scratched that.
Yeah.
We
Yeah.
didn't mention that specific sentence, but
But
we
just
got.
backtrack a bit, just because you mentioned a sympathetic tension, that bringing the string to the crown of the fret is part of that. And it might be a useful thing for the audience to have a quick take home, because you know I guess we've waffled on a bit, and some of it might seem a bit esoteric. If you can have what's a nice practical take home? It's really I've noticed it's a really common thing that even though players don't consciously think about it, if I say to a player, are you trying to press the string to the fretboard? And they go, yeah, I think so. Why? Because if the fretboard wasn't there and the frets still were, what would you actually achieve? You'd just be bending your note for sharp. Now, on vintage instruments, this hardly matters anyway because your intonation isn't going to go out. But a lot of modern instruments, particularly on guitar with jumbo frets, if you press too hard, your intonation goes out. You literally bend the note sharp. But what you want to get used to doing is bringing the string literally to the crown of the fret and no further without any fret buzz. And you can do it one finger at a time where you, the exercise is basically, let's give someone a proper old school typical exercise. So you can have one finger per fret and one fret at a finger at a time. Stop my first finger. I push that down to the crown of the fret, but no further, and keep the other three fingers unmoved. Now they will move. Sympathetic tension, they will. That's how you train it out. And then you can do the second finger and leave. And what you do is you leave those fingers in place, roughly where you think they were in line with the string before you displace the string downwards with that one finger. And then you let the string push the finger back up to meet the other. In reality, what you'll find is, if you're not used to it, you'll do it and fingers will start flying around. And this is a great way to train that out. So if I push my little finger down, the others stay there. My third finger down, my others stay there. Because I've done this a few times in the past. I actually haven't done this exercise for a while. And on a bass, I'm quite pleased. I'm not embarrassing myself on camera. But yeah, so first finger down, the other three stay there. Push it back up. When I say push it up, the string pushes it back up. Well, you just release. And the second finger down, release back up. Third finger down, release back up. Fourth finger down, release back up. You can also pluck the string while you do it, just to make sure you've got enough pressure that it doesn't buzz. Yeah. You can, the other way of doing this, you know, without all keeping it in line and keeping the finger straight, is just to play a note and then release the tension till it just starts buzzing. And then you can, because sometimes you're not always playing like this. This is a great one when you're playing one finger per fret, you know, style. On bass, when you're down here, you might play the more Simandl method, where you're using your little finger, where you're using your little finger and your third finger together.
Yeah, double bass.
So, yeah, exactly. So you know, it's not always appropriate, and I don't have big hands, so I don't often play one finger per fret down here. But you could just hold a string down and then start releasing the tension until it just starts to buzz, and then you go, ah, that's just the right amount. But yeah, basically, make sure you're only playing to the crown of the fret and not the fretboard. The fretboard itself is irrelevant. It's just a placeholder for the frets. You play between the string and the fret.
And for that, the finger needs to be as close to the fret as possible. That's horrible advice that I read in many, many books, that you're supposed to fret a note right in the middle between the two frets.
Oh, that's weird, because I thought it was I've never heard that.
No, I've read that so many times. Maybe it's just German books, but I've definitely seen that. Oh, you need to fret the note right in the middle.
No, because with bar chords, that's part of the advice to make sure when you're playing bar chords, when people struggle with bar chords, that you are right up against the fret as part of the technique. And the other thing about that is you're not, and this could be, you know, I don't have particularly heavy strings. Some people, I think these are 105s, maybe 100s, 105s, I think.
Mine are even thinner.
Well, yeah, because the style you play, yeah. But if you think of the average bass player in a band, you know. But, you know, if you can actually use the weight of your arm, this is so true for bar chords on guitar as well. But if you let your arm drop, there's a pivot point here, your shoulder. So as it doesn't just drop down, it pulls back as well. And that's enough to apply pressure, additional pressure to the fret. So you can actually, if you're, let's just say you're just having to stay on one note for bloody ages on some vamp. If you completely relax your shoulder, basically, the weight of your arm will push your finger into the string anyway.
Yeah. depending on the action.
So you don't actually have to grip at all.
Yeah.
So you can relax the shoulder, relax the arm, and that's enough to pull the hand, the string, into the fret by doing less. And then you can just be there doing AC/DC. Who I love.
All right, Adrian. we already have a comment in saying you need to do an Adrian Farrell Volume 2.
Well, thank you very much. It's a very nice thing to say. There's probably enough to cover as well. Yeah. All I would say is you could probably cover it all by buying the book.
I think so too. You know what?
Plug, you know.
I'm just going to shoot all of your links into the chat. We've got the website. We've got your YouTube channel where there's a couple of videos. Obviously, on the website, you can book a private online lesson, or if you're in the area, then.
My YouTube channel is more. It is not bass or guitar related. It's just pure Alexander Technique.
It's Alexander Technique.
Yeah.
Then we have the Instagram channel, and one more time, definitely support Adrian.
Thank you very much.
I think coming on the show, it's already worth it buying your book. It's really a little spend, and there's a lot of good stuff in there.
Thank you. I know it's hard for the audience. You know, hasn't been a lot of playing. It's just a lot of talk. So I really appreciate you all putting up with me. I hope you got something valuable out of it.
Yeah. You know what? I was just talking with my wife about turning this show into a podcast as well. And I was quite surprised how well we got through this episode without having to rely on the image, really. I mean, obviously, a few things like the head up and forward is a little bit easier to grasp if you see something, but...
I can explain that personally. I could explain that sort of thing, knowing someone can't see. Just say, you know, put your own fingers there. You can feel it, you know.
Yeah.
You can talk people through it.
Nevertheless, I think I'm going to end this episode with a little song.
Oh, lovely.
And then we're just going to say goodbye in private. And everyone else, goodbye and see you next month. Let me think. Yeah, last Saturday of October it's the first Saturday of November, because last Saturday my next guest has a gig and we don't want to cause him to lose a gig, do we? So it's going to be the 4th of November, if I'm completely correct. Anyhow, here's a song, and I'm going to try to be conscious of my breath and at the same time letting go into unconsciousness and being in the moment and letting the music play through me. Let's see how that goes. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for showing up and for everyone watching the replay. You can support Mission Base by shopping at my shop. Links in the comments. And yeah, the shirt that Adrian's wearing, for example, from my last record, or just buy the record, buy a loop bundle, hat, whichever you want, just have a look until 12 o'clock, so 90 more minutes, as the song show was that long. We have a discount going for 15%, and Adrian has his book on Amazon. It'll be there in a matter of days, wherever you are in the world, at least. I think that's how it works with Amazon. It was here very fast when I ordered it.
It's print to order.
Yeah, perfect. And other than that, go and book an appointment straight away. Oh, wait, there was actually one last question that I meant to ask. From, was it Antonio or was it Mike? If you were related to Andy Farrell from Kent.
No.
No. Okay, that was the last question. Now we, I think this is a good point to say goodbye for the last time, as I already did it 3 times. Thank you so much, Adrian.
Thank you.
And see you very soon. Goodbye, everyone. See you next, not really next month, but you know what I mean. Almost next month. Goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you. to put me down. I'm wondering. It's like you want to see me drown. I'm wondering. I really should just hold my ground. I'm wondering. These are the things I'm wondering. Why don't you encourage me? Filling my head negatively. It would be nice for us to get along. Although we fight, but my love for you is strong. I just want you to be proud of me. I hope this song will bring you close to me. A great lesson in humility. I thank God I can see my destiny. I'm wondering why you have to put me down. I'm wondering. It's like you want to see me drown. I'm wondering. I really should just hold my ground. I'm wondering. These are the things I'm wondering. You're seeing clearly now. You search for me when I don't want to be found. You travel into town. Hope it's not too late for you to hear these sounds. I just wanna make you proud. For you I sing this song and rock the crowd. A great lesson in humility. As I thank God that I can see my destiny. I'm wondering why you have to put me down. I'm wondering. It's like you want to see me drown. I'm wondering. I really should just hold my ground. I'm wondering. These are the things I'm wondering. no compensation. It never restores. No compensation. Can never restore. No.